Good evening, everyone. Jacques from Mortgage Allies here. How are you doing on this wonderful, wonderful evening? Well, thank you so much for joining our webinar. Okay, so credit has evolved substantially over the years. And I would say it is probably the thing, as I mentioned in my introduction, that people know the least about. And yet, it is the thing that you should probably know the most about. When it comes to anything, I use a good example of that. When I just became in the industry like 13 years ago, 14 years ago, and you know, I used to go to the local financial institution and say, "Oh, can I please have a credit card?" And because I didn't know what made me eligible for it, I had no idea. Now that I know how it works, I am not arrogant, but I can kind of say, "No, you have no reason not to approve me for a credit card, or why are you raising my credit limit, etc." Because I'm informed in the process, right? And so that's what we're going to achieve for this. Now, here's a sense for you of how credit has evolved. Way back in the day, as a mortgage broker, I would have to go to my clients and meet with my clients and interview my clients and say, okay, so, you know, how much debt do you have? And okay, can you give me that statement? I need to see that, and I'd go through a whole bunch of documents, and I end up with a stack of documents like this in my manila file. I'd get on the subway, I'd go all the way downtown Toronto, and I would meet with my underwriter, and I would sell my client to the underwriter for the purposes of getting a mortgage. So in other words, very little was verified, but there was something was wonderful about that, and that is that you could tell a story. So in other words, if your client missed the payment because one of the spouses were sick or anything, you could explain that, right? That's the human world. The problem with that system was that it took a long time. And so banks wanted, or financial institutions wanted, something that was quicker and more definitive. And so in comes the credit report, okay? And so today, it is very, very seldom that you can tell a story about your credit, okay? It is pretty much everything to do with what your credit score says. So there are a few credit reporting agencies in Canada. There's Equifax Canada, which is most people know them, and TransUnion Canada. Now, these are, remember, these are private institutions. They are not government-owned. They are totally private institutions. And they use this Fair Isaac Corporation, FICO score, okay? It was an engineer, I believe, out of San Francisco, and he put together an algorithm, and now it looks at a whole bunch of things, spits out a number, okay? And that number ranges between 300 and 900, okay? Now, I am happy to tell you, I have never seen a 300, because that's very, very poor. And I've only seen three perfect scores in my entire career, 900, okay? So that is what lenders use. Now, if you're below a certain threshold, which I'll show you later on, you do not qualify for a prime mortgage. Even though you have the most incredible story to tell, you will not qualify for a prime mortgage. That's what's really important to understand, okay? Now, your credit report, I kind of joke with my clients and say, hey, I'm your mortgage broker. I know everything about you. And I'm not too far off when I say that, because I have a list of their liabilities, the payment history, including delinquencies, their home address, their employment history, their when they started credit, their lending risk scores, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. There's a ton of information on there, okay? And so that report is very, very important. And we'll talk about, you know, I just mentioned TransUnion and Equifax. You're like, well, Jacques, this Credit Karma, there's a whole bunch of other, how do they fit into the picture? Well, we will chat about that in a moment, okay? So let's go to the next section here. Now, here is what is very, very, I'm going to imagine I put 10 varies in front of those varies, okay? Here's what you need to remember. Even though your credit is one of the top five things that will determine your mortgage eligibility and the type of mortgage you get, it is not taught, and you are 100% responsible to make sure you know your credit, okay? and know it well. It really is important that you know that well. So credit is, in many ways, it's a on and off switch. If you below 600, you cannot get a prime mortgage, done. No matter what you want to, no matter how much you earn, et cetera, et cetera. That's a sudden death. Where the other ones, it's kind of vague, like not entirely vague, but it's still, you can tell a story. The other, there's five, I said, the other four, you can still kind of tell a story, but credit is pretty sudden death. So it's important you understand how credit works. Okay. So now listen, let me tell you this. I know this stuff can be boring. So I have empathy for you. It's kind of 32 degrees out there. If you fall asleep, you can blame me for being boring, okay? But if you stick with me, this is going to help you a lot in the future, okay? So it's important to also to know that for you to get good credit, there are three categories of mortgages. It's a prime mortgage, what we call alternate mortgages, and also private mortgages. Now, a lot of people will bundle in private with alternate, but we'll chat about that a little bit later. Okay. So here's some tips for you. Okay. As I said, your credit score varies between 300 and 900. Okay. Below 600, you cannot get a prime mortgage anymore. Okay. So below 600, you have to apply for an alternate mortgage, and we'll chat about what an alternate mortgage is after this. Now, traditionally, credit used to be 680, between 680 and, sorry, actually 679 and 650, okay? That used to be what we call slightly A minus. Your ratios get reduced to what you can qualify for. And then between 600 and 649, it's kind of like A minus minus, but remember, it is still A, okay? But you then get what we call your debt service ratios get diminished slightly, okay? And then above 680, then you have what's called plus and up, okay? But now with the mortgage rules changing, you really want to aim for 720. That's where you want to live, okay? So try and keep your credit score higher. That is definitely the rule. Try and keep it. If you're above 800, you really are great. Okay. So how do you get it above 800? Okay. So here's what you want to do. Second one is keep at least two credit facilities and let them each be at least 2 years old. Okay. The older or mature your credit, the better. So what is a facility? A Visa card, a line of credit. This is called facilities. This is our slang in the industry. We call them facilities. Okay. So you want to keep at least two. Now, you may be debt adverse. Shark, I don't need a Visa and a line of credit. I don't like those things at all. I just want to keep one. That's okay. Then at least one for 5 years. Okay? But I would recommend, from a pure mortgage point of view, you need to drive yourself by what is your value system, right? So from a mortgage point of view, I recommend two for two facilities. The reason why I also say two is, If you only have one and you miss by accident a payment, then you don't have much other credit to support your credit report, and your credit is probably going to take a bit of a beating, okay? Number three, sometimes easier said than done, pay your debts on time, every time, and do not miss payments. And I mean, talking about COVID-19, people lose jobs, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, it may not be possible, but fight to the best of your ability to pay your mortgage, your credit facilities on time, every time, and do not miss a payment, okay? So another misconception on credit is, if you carry a balance, then your credit will go down. That's not entirely true. We'll chat about that in a second, okay? Maintain a mix of credit. So in other words, a mix of credit being a credit card and a line of credit, instead of just two credit cards. Look, is the sky going to fall because you have two credit cards and not a line of credit in a credit card? No, it's not. But this will definitely give your credit a bit of a boost, having a mix of credit cards. Okay, so here's a bit of a tip for you. If you believe that you need to get another credit card or line of credit, never do that while you're applying for a mortgage. Never do that. Okay. So, and also do not increase your balance on your line of credit or your credit card or any other debt for that matter while you're in the process of applying for a mortgage, okay? But if you do need to get one, here's what you need to do. Go to your financial institution, and the first thing when you go into financial institution is you can expect if you want a Visa or a line of credit, they're going to say, okay, great, just fill in this form, and you're going to sign that form, right, as you're applying. But most of us, 99% of us, never read through that form. That form says that they have the right to check your credit whenever they want to, and you can be assured they will check your credit, okay? Now, what you want to do is, before you sign that form, you want to go to the institution or you normally bank it and say, listen, I'm looking for a credit card. Can you check if I am pre-approved for one, okay? And that will most likely mean that they may not check your credit, okay? There is a difference, and every institution is different, but try that first, okay? The other thing is, and this one kind of links in with the ones up top here, is keep your balances less than 35% of the limit. So if you have a Visa of $5,000, then keep your balance, okay, the limit is that, keep your balance less than 35% of that limit, okay? Now, understand also that your credit report is not a real-time document, right? That gets only updated once a month. And so just be careful of that, because you could be purchasing something and maybe creep slightly above, you know, 50% or something, and the credit report could be updating, and that's the snapshot it's going to take for you. So try and keep it below that. So am I saying, again, that the sky is going to fall if you go to 40%? No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that's your optimum to drive a credit score of above 800. That's essentially what you want to do, okay? So that's another question and a little bit of a tip here. People say, well, Jacques, my financial institution forever sending me mail, hey, we want to increase your credit limit, increase your credit limit. Should I take that? And I go, first thing that governs you, or what should be governing, is your personal philosophy about finances. If you do not like debt and you've got savings and you do not want more credit, then say no, okay? So from a pure mortgage point of view, that gives you the best odds is if you feel safe and you're comfortable, then take the increase, but only if you're sure that you're not going to spend more money. Why do I say take the increase? Only from a mortgage point of view is that the gap then, if you do carry a balance, the gap between your balance and the credit limit gets slightly bigger, which gives your credit room to breathe and will increase your credit score. Okay? Make sense? Okay. So next one is limit the number of times per year you allow your credit to be accessed. So here is a great tip for you. Whenever you go anywhere and say, oh, I have to make a monthly payment, what would that be? That could be your utility bill. That could be your cell phone bill. It could be your car payment. Somebody is always going to check your credit. Now, no disrespect meant, but the person sometimes sitting behind the desk taking an application doesn't necessarily know why they're pushing the pink button, so to speak, right? And that would mean they check your credit. So you should always be cautious and say, hey, cell phone company, are you going to check my credit? And if they say yes, then say, where's the form that I need to sign to allow you to check my credit? Because we have to ask you in writing for your consent to check your credit, okay? Now, people say, well, Jacques, I've heard that every time somebody checks my credit, my score drops. That is not true, okay? But with a big asterisk, cautious, cautious, caution, caution, caution behind that, okay? Because if you are going to go like 10 times that somebody get your check your credit, yes, it is going to drop your score. But equally, you should not be scared when your mortgage broker says, hey, I need to check your credit, is okay? And they go, wait, you can't check my credit because my score is going to go down. That's not true. Besides, the mortgage broker should not be able to offer you a product if they haven't checked your credit. So it's kind of like, you know, which one goes first. So again, the golden rule is do not just let every Tom, Dick, and Harry check your credit, but those that you are seriously intending to do a business with, they need to check your credit, okay? And if you're not serious about doing this with a person, then don't let them check your credit, okay? Right, hopefully this is helpful to you so far. And the next one is, if you miss payments, contact the lender quickly and explain your situation. So here is, you know, if you've been brought up with great values, if you miss a payment, guess what happens? We feel shame, right? We feel shame and like, you know, we kind of berate ourselves and stuff like that. So we kind of, many of us just believe, oh, well, this is how it goes away, okay? Do not ever do that. Contact the financial institution proactively because they will contact you if you go over, okay? And then it's not, then it's on their terms. So call them right away and say, man, I'm so sorry. I've missed a payment here, et cetera, et cetera. Now I can, again, I can literally spend, you know, a month of Sundays on this topic, but be careful talking to your bank, be very careful, or your financial institution, say, look, don't worry, we'll make payment arrangements for you. That word should scare you right off up front. It could be innocent, meaning they'll allow you to pay it off in $50 a month or something, or it could also be what's called debt counseling. Okay, and that is not good for your credit. So be very, very careful about that. Inquiry is important. So ask, what do you mean you're going to create a payment plan for me? Okay, so that you understand what that means. Okay. And then here's an important one. Don't depend entirely on what we call an installation loan to build your credit. In other words, car loans. Installation loans are, it's $500 a month for 5 years until you pay the car off. That's what's called an installation loan. Okay, so installation loans, they are very important. They, if you miss them, they kind of, if you miss the payment on an installation loan, they kind of call they, we call them a mini mortgage, because it's like a, you're paying something off over a 5 year period with a regular payment. Kind of sounds like a mortgage, right? So they're very important, but do not entirely depend on them, because guess what happens? You're going to pay that car off, right? Guess what happens to your credit then? That loan collapses, and with it, if that was the only thing you depended on, with that will your credit will collapse. So you want to depend essentially long-term-wise on like a line of credit or a Visa or something like that, okay? Okay, we're getting there. So next one on the credit tips is, if you decide to close a credit facility, now remember I said to you, if that's that old Visa that's like 20 years old and you're like, I don't use this thing. I really want to close it. You want to think twice about that, because that 20-year-old Visa that you may not be using is certainly pushing up your credit score like crazy because it's mature, okay? So watch for that. But if you do close it, so let's just say you carried a balance of $2,000, okay? You go and you pay off that $2,000 and you say to the financial institution, okay, could you please close that card for me, please? And you're happy, woohoo, finally you paid off that card and you finally it's off your back, right? Now remember, that $2,000, there may still be interest that's remaining that you still have to pay on that money. So what happens to so many of my clients, and sadly, they close the card and they get a statement from the bank and they go, this must be an old document because I already closed it, okay? But there may be $25 of interest that you may owe. And if you don't pay that month, then it goes into default. And then eventually, like 4 months overdue, you get a phone call from a collection agency like, you owe us $25. Like, what? I don't owe you $25. And that's what happens. So always remember, when you close something, when you pay it off, wait about a month. Make sure you pay that last interest. And then you say, close the account. Okay? Now, here's another tip I want to give you, a very important tip that you do. This is what I do. In fact, I just closed one of my Visa cards, okay? Here's what you do. You insist, absolutely insist, that the lender or the financial institution gives to you in writing that they have closed the account and that they have stopped reporting to the credit reporting agency. That's like Equifax, okay? Why do I say that? Because imagine this, I owe you money. While I owe you money, you're going to make sure that you keep me straight. Like, you're going to report on my behavior. But the moment I paid you back, well, you don't care in a sense because you got your money back, right? And equally, unintentionally, our financial institutions are not, when we owe them money on a Visa, they keep on reporting on our behavior, right? But the moment we pay them off, guess what happens? They sometimes don't close those facilities at Equifax. And that thing keeps on ticking on there with a zero balance, but it's still active, okay? Now, only once they've stopped reporting to the credit reporting agency, 6 years from that date, does that credit facility go off your credit report. So you want to make sure that you have it in writing that you've asked them to stop reporting to a credit facility, to the credit bureau, so that that thing can go off your report in 6 years. I know what I just said is a whole mouthful, but just remember to ask them that, okay? And insist that you get it in writing. Don't do the, don't accept that, yeah, don't worry, we got this. No. I want it in writing, okay? That's important for you. Okay, so the next thing is, clients call me up and say, hey, Jacques, I'm looking for a mortgage, but I'll give you my Credit Karma score, and then you'll be fine, right? No, unfortunately not, okay? And even if a client goes to Equifax and prints their credit score, their credit report with the score and gives it to me, I cannot use that. And the reason why I cannot use that is because we have to, it's important for you to know, lenders will only accept credit reports checked by themselves or an authorized third party, such as a mortgage broker for mortgage application purposes, okay? So as much as I appreciate what some of the free credit report agencies are doing, I really appreciate that. They have different algorithms, and honestly, from my mortgage point of view, that may be very helpful for you, and I encourage you to use those, but you cannot entirely rely on those, okay? Because I've seen massive differences between a free credit report facility and what we have to pull. Because when we pull something from, let's just say, Equifax or TransUnion, those scores are weighted for lending, and they give us a, you know, certain scores on there. So just be very careful. So monitor it absolutely for your own self, but do not, you know, your mortgage broker should not rely on that to even closely evaluate you for a mortgage, okay? The other thing is, I want to give you a tip here. This is a big deal. So I understand how, you know, how financial institutions work and how the whole system fundamentally is actually trained clients with regards to credit. So a client calls up and says, what's your interest rates? Anybody who's giving you an interest rate there, you got to be careful, because you should only accept the quote once somebody's actually do a proper evaluation of who you are in your credit, et cetera, et cetera. Anything else is anecdotal. It's like an opinion. It's really not worth much, okay? While it could be something that you could use to plan, it's important to know that do not accept any, you know, opinions or letters or anything until you've done a proper credit check, your broker's done a proper credit check, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. Right. So here's another one that I see so often is you talk to clients and say, hey, listen, I'm gonna need your social insurance number because I need to check your credit. And people say, and it, respectfully, they'll say, no, I've been told never to give my SIN number out. And I go, okay, that's fine. I totally respect where you're coming from. But understand this, you will not be able to get a mortgage or a loan unless you give your social number to the financial institution. So then some people may say, well, I don't have to give my social insurance number to the institution. I go, yes, that's right. But again, respectfully, the bank doesn't have to give you a mortgage either, okay? So it's kind of like a cat and mouse game. You know, you don't have to, absolutely. Nobody has to give their social insurance number to an institution for a mortgage or any loan for that matter, but neither does the financial institution, okay? So I can tell you from my experience, I said here, the vast majority of lenders, I would almost say from my experience, every lender will insist on a SIN number before they issue a loan, okay? So a note for you is do not give your SIN number to every Tom, Dick, and Harry, but first establish that you can work with a person that you are wanting to work with. Do they have credibility? Do they have systems in place that protect your information? And once you're there, then go ahead, give your SIN number to people. But also check a few things, right? If you're going to send it by email, be very careful because email is as wide open as a barn door. If you're going to send it by email, what we do with our clients is we send them an encrypted email, and then they reply to that encrypted email, okay? Another one you can use is, I'm not an Android guy, so the Android guys up here, you can You can nail me later, okay? But iMessage to iMessage is encrypted, okay? Also, WhatsApp is encrypted. So you can send it through that. Or, of course, you know, voice can also be, of course, be grabbed, but voices on a phone. I typically try and ask my clients for their certain numbers over the phone so I can have it, okay? I've probably belabored the point like crazy, but hopefully it helps you. All right, so now let's dive into prime, the mortgage types I was referring to before. You got prime mortgages, you got alternate mortgages, now, and you got private mortgages. Now, some people lump these in there. I like to separate them slightly because this is fully regulated. This is fully regulated by the government. This is not, from a mortgage point of view, regulated by the government. Okay, so be very, very careful when you know that. So what is the difference between a prime mortgage, alternate, et cetera, et cetera? Now, you know, when I talk about this stuff, of course, you know, I'm making a lot of assumptions just by listening to me. Obviously, it doesn't mean you have a mortgage. You know, we're all mature adults here. I'm giving scenarios out here to help you understand. Okay, so lots of disclaimers here. You can read them up here. They're all out there, and there's a lot more. So just be aware of that. Okay, so first of all, to get a prime mortgage, traditionally verified income. In other words, I'm going to ask you for every single document that you can ever imagine, and it can be painful. I kind of joke with my clients sometimes, feels like we're asking you for DNA samples at the end of the day. You know, it's a lot. I totally get it. On the alternate side, they're way more relaxed about it. For argument's sake, if somebody's self-employed here, let's just say they have a corporation, I'm going to have to ask for the articles of incorporation. I'm going to have to ask for 2 years financial statements. I'm going to have to ask for the T1 generals. I'm going to ask for the notice of assessments like it's crazy. On this side here, probably only the articles of incorporation and 12 months bank statements. Boom. That's it. Okay. Much quicker. On the private side, you can see here, like limited. It is literally how that lender feels. Okay. They can make it up as they go completely. And you'll see why they so relaxed in a second. Okay. Credit score requirements. For you to get any prime mortgage, you must have a score above 600, okay? And as I said, you definitely want to try and keep your credit above 720. On the prime side, we also accept new to Canada people. So what is new to Canada people? You know, I'm an immigrant, I've been here for 20 years, but it's basically somebody who's just come to the country and they've been here for less than 5 years. So their credit would not have been built entirely. Those are called new to Canada people. Foreign purchases are also eligible. Those are people who are literally living in another country. They want to buy real estate in Canada. They can do that without any credit in Canada, okay? On the alternate side, that is not possible. Now, you can see, look at the difference in scores with an alternate lender, okay? So they'll accept blemish credit, where some will even go as low as 495, okay? On the private side, not much at all. They ask for a credit report, but it's totally up to the lender. So kind of like, well, I'm not saying much on this side. You're absolutely right, because it's as wide open as what that lender decides it to be, okay? We want established credit to facilities, as I talked about here. It's up to the lender's guideline. They may not require that, okay? On the delinquency side, that's a big differentiator. You can only have minor delinquencies, okay? You can have, let's just say somebody has had a collection and they've paid it off, then yes, that will still be able to get done. But if it's too much, then you will not be able to get a prime mortgage. So important to note that, okay? And normally when we meet with a client, here's another tip for you. If you decide to buy a house, okay, this sounds crazy, but I would even meet with a mortgage broker 1 year ahead of time. Why do I say that? Especially if you've kind of like a suspicion that you've got maybe some damaged credit, okay? Because then you give the mortgage broker to give you some tips to correct the things that are you know, imperfect. I met with some clients of mine the other day, and I've been working with them for 4 years, and they have not bought a house yet. But I'm going to tell you, when I met with them, their credit score was about 580. They both have 850 scores right now. And now all the tails are up, they're confident, and they can go buy a house with a prime mortgage, and we've corrected those things, okay? Another tip for you. if you're not sure of what your credit is like, it's, again, many people freeze and they're like so scared of the topic, they don't know how to approach it. I would recommend go to your broker, meet with a broker, do an analysis, determine right up front what you can afford or buy for a home, and they will point out anything that a good broker anyway should be doing that, okay? Helping you to correct that, okay? So on the alternate side, oh, by the way, this used to be called subprime mortgages, okay? But that's a swear word these days, and everybody's trying to run away from that. Now, subprime, as it used to be prior to 2007, and what alternate mortgages are today, are vastly different. That's another reason why we are moving away from the word of subprime. Because subprime is like literally, can you afford a mortgage? You can get a mortgage. Not like that at all. It was never like that in Canada, actually, at all. So that's why we moved away from, because of the connotations that come with subprime. Okay. So delinquencies, they will allow you to have some delinquencies and even deal with past bankruptcies or consumer proposals. Okay. There may be some conditions, but they will look at it. Where on the prime side, there are some lenders that allow it, but they're very, very strict on it. If you've gone through a consumer proposal or a bankruptcy, you cannot miss payments after that. If you miss payments after on your credit report after that, it would be almost impossible to get your prime mortgage, okay? All right, so, and again, private lenders deal with pretty much any of that stuff. Here's something that somebody that you may not know, is you cannot get a prime mortgage if you owe any income taxes or property taxes or condo fees, okay? Those things are not allowed. You cannot owe any of those taxes. And they have to be paid off before you get the mortgage. You cannot pay them off if you're refinancing from the mortgage proceeds. That's a very important thing to know that. And they do, alternate lenders will allow you to pay taxes off from your mortgage if you're refinancing, and will allow some tax stuff. So we're almost there, okay? So on the prime mortgage, we can go down to 5% down payment. So just to remind you of the rules, there's so many people that currently own a home. One of my clients who've been, unfortunately, fallen in hard times, had to sell their home. And so they asked, can I still buy a house afterwards? I'm like, of course you can. So the mortgage rules in Canada say this: for a house below $500,000, okay, if it's a principal resident, that is 5% down payment, okay? For a house that is less than $1 million, I am drawing with a mouse, forgive me, okay? And more than 500K, okay, for that, we take 5% of the first 500K, okay? This is, by the way, in another webinar as well. And then we take 10% of the amount over $500,000 and below $1 million, okay? Anything over $1 million, definitely 20% down payment, okay? And if you go even higher, then there's even a sliding scale, okay? But we can do this on the prime mortgage side. On the alternative mortgage, mostly 20% and sometimes even more, okay? You get definitely the lowest interest rates on the prime side. You get higher than prime mortgage. And now I've got some examples for you down here just to show how it works. And of course, on the private side, 20% minimum, they may even ask for more. And your interest rates, welcome for joining us. Somebody just joined us. Is definitely the highest. And on the, this is an important differentiator too. On the prime side, typically lenders will lend anywhere where real estate is marketable, okay? That means literally anywhere, most areas, okay? It has to be marketable. The house has to be in good condition for sure, okay? We, by the way, we have a great product, if you didn't know about it, it's called the Purchase Price Improvements. If you're buying a house, we can add up to 40,000 or 10% of the purchase price to the house for renovations, okay? We can chat about it if you have any questions about that. And on this, on the alternate side, prime and marketable real estate, okay? And only in major urban centers, okay? These lenders do not like wells and septics. They don't like them. Or if they do, they can ask for 35% down. So these lenders are, they put a lot more emphasis on the real estate than on the actual borrower themselves. Okay, important to know that. And these people, I mean, I have had people literally take a house that should really be demolished because the person couldn't get a mortgage anywhere else, but they want to fix this property up and then, you know, make something of it. Then a private lender will fund that for sure. Okay, if you can find one, but they typically will do that kind of stuff. Okay, so I've actually done some examples for you so that there's nothing like an example to kind of to just clear the fog, right? So how bad is an alternate mortgage and how bad is a prime mortgage? Okay. So what I'm doing here is here's a prime mortgage, alternate mortgage, and a private mortgage. In this little blue one here, I have to sneak this one in because I want to compare this one directly with this one. Okay. So let's just say clients have got 720 Beacon score, they're buying for $500,000. Remember I told you they can put as little as 5% down. They pay mortgage insurance. That's what somebody called a CMHC insurance, okay? And their mortgage is going to be 494. That is not the current rates. We've got definitely got better rates than that. I'm just using a cookie cutter rate, okay? And if you put less than 20% down, you cannot go higher than 25 years. I just used a 5-year term for no particular reason. The mortgage payment, which includes the principal and interest. Principal is the amount of the payment that goes off against the balance of the mortgage, okay? And this person needs to earn an income of $103,000 to be able to buy that house. Now, no lender fee, no brokerage fee. It's a prime mortgage, okay? Okay, now let's look at an alternate mortgage. This person has a score of 580, or they may have a score of 780, very high score, but all the income does not add up to what they need to qualify. So the self-employed person has lots of money in the company, for argument's sake, but they don't want to take all the money and pay taxes on it, so they leave money in the company and they take only some out. So they may have, let's just say, a 780 credit score, but they don't meet the traditional income verification guidelines, so now they have to go and get an alternate mortgage. So 500,000, same purchase price. Imagine these people, you know, 20% down. The mortgage will be this much, so 500 minus 100, the mortgage will be 400,000. So these folks in this example get 2.8, these folks get 4.5. You're like, man, that is crazy. Well, we'll check it out in a second. 30-year amortization, they can go to 30-year. Now, always an alternative mortgage is normally designed, this is what I do, is designed, excuse my little ridiculous sketch here, okay? Here is the client is standing at a big Grand Canyon, okay? And they want to get to here, but there's this big hole called either bad credit or too little income, but they want to get to the other side, okay? So what do? We kind of build a bridge there. We say, well, that bridge, let's say, is going to take 2 years to build, and we only get them a 2-year term so they can get across, and on the other side, we go, woohoo, we can now get them a prime mortgage, okay? This is a bridge. So there's actually a mortgage type called a bridge loan, so don't confuse the two. It's like my bridge to get the client from one place to another, okay? So in this case, the client's going to pay a payment of $2,016.86, okay? And they need an income of $80,500. So what? That's quite a bit less than that, right? Okay, well, here we're not really comparing apples to apples because here we're putting 20% down, and here we're only putting 5% down. Now, let's look at this example, okay, where we are comparing apples to apples. So $500,000 purchase price, $100,000 just like this one here. The mortgage is $400,000, just like this one here. The rate's 2.89. There is your differentiator right there. Now, by law, in a prime mortgage, we can go to 30 years if we have more than 20% or 20% down payment. Here, I'm using a 5-year. Now, this is where it all happens. There's your payment, $1,659 versus $201,686. And you need $81,000 to qualify. So, I'll let you be the judge. Which is better? Without question, this is better, okay? But now imagine for a second, okay, your credit's not perfect. but you want to get into a house. You're sick and tired of not buying or owning your own house, or you've got debts to pay off and stuff like that, okay? The difference between these two payments is what? $430, plus minus $430, okay? So imagine somebody says, nope, I'm not getting an alternate mortgage. So let me tell you this, I'm not advocating for alternate mortgages. I do about 98.9% of my mortgages are all prime mortgages. Okay, so it's not like I'm majoring on alternate. I know how to do them. I do them often, and I know how they work, okay? But imagine this. Let's just say for 2 years, this person says, nope, I'm not going to get this mortgage, all right? What if the housing market goes up by 5% per year, okay? So in other words, what this person will have to do is, if they don't want to get an alternate mortgage, they have to save. So 430 times 12, let's just say it's $5,000. So this will cost them $10,000 more. This mortgage will cost them $10,000 more over 2 years. But if the housing market goes up by 5% per year, they are actually falling more behind if they do that. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is an alternate mortgage definitely has its place. Okay, evaluate it. If you're working with a mortgage broker who does not point out the difference, don't work with them. As simple as that. It is fair to help you understand why this may be a solution for you, if it is what you're happy to do and if it's that you're prepared to take that risk. Okay. Okay. So the next one is a private mortgage. I'm going to spend very little time on this because, honestly, be careful. Be very careful. I can't say it enough because these folks are one. They may be wonderful folks, but they're also looking after their own money, and they don't want to be caught with a borrower who doesn't pay their mortgage. So in this example, I just said, okay, let's just say that this lender asked for a 25% down payment. The mortgage is going to be 3%. It's not unusual to be charged 11% or even higher than that, okay? What's the payment here? The payment's gonna be $3,437.50, and it's interest only, okay? You are not paying any principal back, okay? And after that 1 year term, that's typically what you're gonna get, there is no guarantee that that lender will renew that mortgage, okay? To be very, very careful about that. Now, if I may be naughty for a second, okay? Watch this. This is a high interest rate. We would both agree or not. I would, you know, if you walked into my office and I go, hey, Sean, I'll tell you, I've got a 11% mortgage for you. Like, why are you getting excited? That sounds horrible. Like, why would you offer me 11% mortgage? You're right. It is horrible. I would never do that to my clients. But remember this. You sign up and I sign up every single day for a Visa card at 19%. And guess what? We never ask why. We just sign and accept it, okay? And so it is definitely, I am not advocating for this. This is a last resort option, okay? And if you even want to call it a last resort, it may be better, you'd have to evaluate your circumstances, to sell your house before you have to get in it, unless you're an investor who can stomach that and you can, you know, build wealth through it, okay? But it is all about conditioning. We sign up for 90% credit cards every single day without questioning it, okay? If you sign up for a store credit card, guess what that is? Typically, 28%, okay? So if I may step a little bit on my soapbox, not that I'm not on it already, but is if the government wants to control our debt situation, look at this stuff. This is all very regulated, right? If the government wants to control our debt situation in Canada, it may be better for them to put more rules on unsecured debt, such as credit cards and lines of credit. Okay, imagine that, because they'll control that stuff a lot more. Okay, I'll get off my soapbox now. How's that? So hopefully this gives you a sense that if you don't have a perfect situation, or you are a self-employed person and you don't tick all the boxes that you need to tick, this may be a very legitimate circumstance for you or solution for you to get you in a situation where you can actually qualify for a prime mortgage down the road. Another tip for the self-employed amongst us here, if you are going to get a mortgage, those last 2 years before you get your mortgage, make sure that you don't diminish your income, because a lot of people say, well, I don't want to pay too much taxes. I get it. But if you don't pay too much taxes, you may end up paying too much mortgage interest as well, right? So you have to balance those two off. So you have to have a very good conversation with your accountant. I cannot believe I've been speaking and you've actually stayed awake. Hopefully you stayed awake for like 40 minutes. I can't believe it. So hopefully this is good for you. Thank you so much for your time. We will see you the next month, the last Tuesday of the month. We'll send out the invitations, the same spot here. Looking forward to have a great conversation with you. In the meantime, take care of yourself and God bless you. Stay safe. Bye-bye.